Hello everyone and welcome back to Dave and just two of his wheels. This is going to be a review of my Cube Litening Super HPC. This bike I've had for about 2 years and it is part of the Cube's flagship road range. Now I got this bike after realising that the carbon fibre is the way forward for road bikes, it just is. It's lighter, stiffer, and it's just way much more cooler than alloy, my personal opinion. There's guys out there who'll probably disagree with that. But the Cube Litening, this I paid, without being vulgar, just purely for the review, I paid £2,800 for this bicycle back in 2012 when it was the current model. The only difference that I've done with it since is I've put a different set of wheels on it and a different stem. The wheels that come on it, they were adequate, but they were the Cube's own wheels mated to a set of DT Swiss rims. Don't get me wrong, they were good wheels, but they were a little bit weighty and they just seemed a bit flexy as well. So I lashed out a thick end of another £500 and I got myself those Mavic Caserium Elite S wheels, which, again, it's only my opinion, but I think you're struggling to get a better alloy wheel set than those. For the money, for everything, they're as light as you can get for the money. And they're just super, super stiff, and the bike just seems to accelerate a lot quicker with them on. It just seems to pick up, you just don't seem to waste any of the initial kick you put into your crank when you want to sort of speed up really quick. Now this bike comes with SRAM's very, very excellent and very, very lightweight red 20 group set. Now it's pretty much all carbon fibre, that group set. It's SRAM's current top one, although the current group set they do is a SRAM Red 11. It's got 11 teeth on the back instead of 10. But this group set was what the likes of Mark Cavendish was using circa 2012. It's a fully cable group set, and it is, as I said, super light. And with those Mavic wheels on and that group set, I am not BSing you here, the bike weighs just a little over 14 pounds. You'd have to put ballast on it if you wanted to use it in a UCI race. And it's a proper race bike as well. All you true race enthusiasts out there will be looking at that stem and thinking, oh my God, that's terrible, get that thing slammed. Well, I'm 43 years old. When it came, it had 10 mil short, it was a 90 mil stem on it, and it was fully slammed down to the steerer tube, and basically my nose was lower than my arse, and it was just too uncomfortable to ride. At the end of the day, I've got to be able to ride this thing all day, so I swapped the spacers around. Thankfully Cube had thoughtfully left enough of the steerer tube on it so that you could fiddle around with the spacers, and I also got a 10 mil longer stem and set it the other way around, so it's still pretty low, but it's comfortable now, and I can ride that all day, and I have ridden it all day on many occasions, sort of 9 hours in some cases, and my lower back might get sore, but as I mentioned in previous videos, I've got a bit of a dicky shoulder, but the position that you get into on a road bike seems to favour me old knackered shoulder, because my elbows are in and everything's tucked in, and it just seems a lot much more comfortable way to be. I tried to do a video yesterday on it and I kept getting punctures in the back tyre, so that's why the back tyre doesn't match. That's got me spare on, so I'll probably get another one to match the front as soon as the season's over and it gets put away for the winter. But looks-wise, it's a pretty smart-looking bike. I wasn't all that struck on the colour scheme when I first got it, but it's kind of grown on me over the last couple of years, and I do like it. I mean, I mean a lot, but I don't mean, what I'm saying is it's got the steering bearing is a ceramic unit, and everything else is very lightweight. The frame, for example, has no alloy inserts in it whatsoever. The bottom bracket, the dropouts, it's all just straight carbon fibre. It just saves those grams that top end bikes need. Probably means it'll wear out a bit quicker, but it's done me for 2 years. It's not showing any signs of fatigue yet or anything. So you know, it's just a really nice, comfy bike. When I go out for a ride in a minute and just talk about it, you'll notice that there's a bit of a clicky sound coming from it. That's nothing at all to do with the bike itself. It's these titanium bottle cages that I bought for it. They were very expensive, and both of them have broken at the top here, which is very, very annoying because they were really expensive and they both broke. So that's what that sort of clicky noise is you'll hear. Also, the ceramic front end, it's one of the few faults I've got on this bike. The ceramic bearings seem to buzz and there's nothing I can do. I've taken them apart, put them back together again. They just seem to buzz, but I've kind of got used to it. So, you know, make do. The rest of the bike pretty much is. Everything's carbon fibre, even the seat rails, and the seat itself is fully carbon fibre. It's got the Luke carbon fibre pedals on it, which squeak a bit, but with a little spray of WD-40, that takes that away. And all in all, it's a very, very nice bike. So, I'll just put my bottles back in, and we'll take it for a little spin, and I'll talk you through it from a rider's perspective. Now, it's a 53 tooth chain set. It's a standard chain set, this bike, which makes it super fast on the flats and going downhill and things like that. It's not so good for getting up hills. It'll get up them, but you've got to put a lot of muscle into it. And the steepest, worst climbs that I've ever gone up on it is a UCI grade 3, one being high, four being low. And I would not like to take it up anything more challenging than a 3, because it's just really, really, really hard to pedal uphill with the standard chain set on it, no matter how light it is. First thing I really noticed about this bike was just how fast it picks up speed. Now, I'd never ridden a standard chain set before I got this bike, but I've really took a bit of getting used to, because they're so much harder to pedal, especially when you're not naturally fit. But as I've got fitter on this bike, I find it actually better than a compact chain set, because I don't go climbing Mount Ventoux every day. You know, I have a commute that goes up a Cat 4, but it manages a Cat 4 quite easily. But it is just so fast getting up hills, and it's got a very short wheelbase, so it's quite nimble. I saw the Colne GP a couple of years ago, not long after I got this. That's a criterium race in the Lancashire town of Colne, and one of the professional teams was using these, which made me very chuffed, because they were running them in the same spec as this, albeit they had full carbon tubular wheels on them. So I don't know how Cube do it, because I've priced this bike up individually by its component parts, and I can't see how they've done it. I don't know where they've made a profit. It must just be volume selling, because if you add the parts up, it's like about £400 or £500 more expensive to build it yourself. But as it's got such a short wheelbase, makes it very nimble and very, very quick to turn. And because there's not much mass in the bike, mean, I am by far and away the greatest mass on the bike. It stops really quick too, because I've got what they call Swiss Tech brake pads in it, and they're really good, quite long lasting for an expensive brake pad as well, but they stop really well, they don't squeal. But one thing, one of the many things I like about this bike is going downhill, is just how fast it picks up speed. You probably won't be able to hear me as I go down the hills fast. And this is a very bumpy hill, but all that carbon fibre really absorbs the road. You've still got to pick your way through the potholes though. I mean, I'm not even pedaling. I'm doing like 35 miles an hour. Not even trying. It just wants to roll on and roll on. That, you know, I was touching 40 miles an hour down there without putting a single pedal crank turn in. It just rolls on. But I'll show you now in this little section here what happens when you actually do pedal it in a bit. Now this next bit, it has a bit of a downhill kicker to go, but it's largely flat. So get it into top gear here and you really put some effort in. Get it in top, get on the drops, put it in. And this just takes off. Now it's flat from here. Even though I'm in a bit of a headwind, it just keeps the speed. I'm doing 32 miles an hour. I'm not really putting maximum effort in. It just rolls on and on. And if I wasn't speaking to you fellas, I'd have kept that on all the way into Hawkshire Village, which is about another half mile. And that's the difference between a good quality road racing bike and like your entry level ones. They're just that bit faster. They're disproportionately fast for the, sorry, they are disproportionately expensive, I should say, for the amount of gains you get. For example, my old Boardman, which I don't have anymore, I sold to a friend of mine. I used to be able to ride that to work in something like 35 minutes. It was about a 12 mile route in the place I used to work. This does it, the same route, same effort, does it in like 25, 26. It's just so much more faster over your segments, it just picks up speed, you don't seem to lose as much on it. And the way I've got the cockpit set up, it's very comfortable as well. When I first got it, it wasn't. It was a little bit too radical. But for all you young boys and girls, with the fitness and the determination to do some proper road racing, this has got to be where your money's got to get spent, because you put this next to any Italian bike, any American bike, and your money seems to go a third as far again. The same money on an American bike, you're looking at an Ultegra group set or an equivalent SRAM, like a SRAM Force or something. But with this one, you're getting the full top end carbon professional group set. And the bike, you just, except maybe for the wheels, the bike's just ready to race straight out of the box. It is just such a good bike. I'll keep repeating that because I noticed I do repeat myself a lot on these videos, bit of filler, but it's just such a well built, well thought out, usable road racing bike, and that you know, just for a little pleasure ride out, for commuting to and from work, or for dropping the stem down, slamming it and going, sticking yourself right in the middle of a high-end peloton, the bike will do it all. And I've been riding this one for 2 years and I've absolutely no inclinations to change. I know the industry is now going towards hydraulic group sets for brakes and electronic group sets. Unless you're a super, super pro, in which case you can't have hydraulic group sets yet because they're against UCI rules. But unless you're a super pro, you don't need electronic group sets. You don't need hydraulic group sets unless you ride in the middle of winter, then I can kind of see the benefit of hydraulic disc brakes. But they just add weight. And the thing I like about this bike is the fact that I can't, I'm not young enough or good enough to be a pro rider. This is the kind of thing that the pros are using. You know, albeit it's very, very entry level for them, but you know, it's a 3K carbon weave, super lightweight frame bike with a largely carbon fiber group set. So that's carbon fiber handlebars, carbon fiber seat, the crank arms are carbon fiber, the head bearings are ceramic, brake levers, gear levers, everything is carbon. All for less than 3,000 quid. Which, if you're not into cycling, you're thinking, what? How much? But trust me, you can run twice that, and for twice that, you would not get a fifth of a good bike than this is now. And that's the disparity in bicycles and their expense versus gains. You start off on a £500 bike, you double it, you triple it, but you're not doubling and tripling what you're getting out of it. So this for me is about as much as I'm happy spending on a road bike for what it gives me. I could afford a Pinarello Dogma if I wanted one, but at £8,000, you know, it's not gonna be 2 and a bit times better than this. How's it, heck? It might take 30 seconds off a mile or something like that for me, but as I've previously said, I'm 43 years old. I'm never going to ride competitively, I'll never ride for myself. And this, the Cube Litening Super HPC, is about all that your average weekend warrior roadie needs to spend on a bike. And for your £3,000, you get a superb machine that goes like clappers. It'll do everything you ask of it. Can't speak highly enough of one. I'd recommend anyone who's wanting a new road bike at higher spec is look at Cube while we still remain good value, because at some point, whatever financial trick they're pulling off to keep these bikes at this price, it's going to come to an end. It's got to do. because they've all been loss leaders as far as I can see. So get them while they're good and get one and you won't regret it, guarantee you. That's really all I can really say on the Cube Litening. So I'll wrap this edition up for here. So as always, if you're so inclined, feel free to hit the like button, to comment, to either abuse or congratulate me. Or if you feel so inspired, hit the subscribe button, and I'll see you later.